Mussolini's mistress was Jewish. She was also a member of the Fascist Party of Italy, as were 10,000 other Jews, a third of the adult population of Jews in Italy. These are facts that may surprise and confuse a lot of people, because we've all been told, over and over, that fascists are racists and hate Jews, and yet you've just heard evidence that directly contradicts that assumption. So what's going on here? How come everyone is saying that fascists are racists, and yet there were 10,000 Jews in the Fascist Party of Italy? Where fascism came from? Even Orwell points this out. Antisemitism is supposed to be one of the distinguishing marks of fascism, but some fascist movements are not antisemitic. Orwell is correct. The original fascism, Italian fascism, really wasn't antisemitic or racist. Now, I know some are going to jump down my throat and say, what about the anti-Semitic laws in 1938? But as I've mentioned in other videos, this was because of Hitler's influence over Mussolini, and Italy wanting to be allies with the Germans at the time, not because of fascist doctrine itself. It was a strategic and political move, which is why the laws didn't result in any deaths until the Germans came. Also, the laws were anti-religious, not anti-race, as Farrell explains, and as I've explained in an old video on this topic, so I'm not going to go over the whole thing again. In fact, this is why many of the Jews in Italy were exempt from the discrimination, including people who had served in the Italian armed forces, and their families, and anyone in the fascist party plus their families. So, basically, over a third of the Jews in Italy weren't targeted by these laws. Fascist racism throughout the period between 1922 and 1938, however distinctive, was essentially benign, and shared little, if any, substance with the malevolent racism so prevalent across the Alps. None of the major fascist intellectuals were racists of the sort one found in National Socialist environs. In fact, since many, if not most, of the principal ideologues of fascism were actualists, they had principled objections to attributing human behavior to material, that is, biological causes. They simply could not accept the proposition that an entire population characterized by ill-defined racial traits could be held as a body guilty of anything. The form of antisemitism adopted by Fascist Italy as a consequence was singularly different from that of National Socialist Germany. However indecent, it shared few of the genocidal traits that have horrified the civilized world. Italian Jews suffered innumerable indignities and material losses, but there is scant, if any, evidence that between 1938 and 1943 any Jews died at the hands of fascists simply for having been Jewish. In addition, it's clear that Fascist Italy was nowhere near as violent towards its own population as National Socialist Germany or the Marxist Socialist Soviet Union. Only 12,310 people were arrested by 1940 during Mussolini's pre-World War II reign. Of them, only a handful were sentenced to death, mainly for plotting to assassinate Mussolini. Compare this to the 14 million people murdered in what Timothy Snyder calls the Bloodlands by the Soviet Union and National Socialist Germany between the years 1933 and 1945. Stalin alone put 680,000 people to death during 1937 and 1938 in what is known as the Great Terror or the Purges. So, in terms of scale, Fascist Italy was incredibly mild by comparison to the Third Reich or the Soviet Union. And yet, the term fascism conjures up a host of evil connotations, and is used to smear opponents to this day. Well, while fascism was a bad political, social, and economic system, and I'm certainly not defending it, it was nothing like as evil as National Socialism or Marxist Socialism. In our modern world, Marxists can wander around with their blood-red banners spouting anti-Semitism, which is inherent in the doctrine, and calling for the theft and murder of the Judeo-bourgeoisie, and nobody bats an eyelid. For some reason, it has managed to avoid the stigma that fascism and Nazism have gained, when in reality Marxism is actually multiple times worse than fascism and is comparable to Nazism in many, many ways. Well, I have figured out exactly how and why fascism gained the reputation that it did, even though this reputation clearly isn't justified. Again, I'm not defending fascism, it is still a stupid ideology, and I'm not a fascist. But I'm also not going to pretend that it's something that it isn't, like the enemies of science are trying to do. So, in this video, what I'm going to do is define what fascism is, and give some history in the process. Then I'm going to explain the difference between fascism and Nazism, which is the question being asked by one of my patrons, and many other viewers as well. And then solve the mystery as to why fascism gained a reputation that simply doesn't represent it. Let's start off then in the 1800s. We have a bunch of workers' trade unions in Italy. A trade union can also be called a syndicate, which is from the French term for trade union. So when you hear the word syndicalism, this just means trade unionism. At first, syndicalism evolved as part of the Marxist-Socialist movement, but then branched away from it due to the failure of Marxism in practice. The basic idea is that workers would form trade unions that would control the means of production, the factories and so on. Syndicalism therefore pronounced itself anti-state and anarchist, which is why oxymoronic terms like anarcho-syndicalism exist. Through strikes, it intended to bring capitalism to an end, replacing it not by state socialism, but by a society of producers. Which is the same thing, right? A society of producers is state socialism. A society that organizes itself politically and governs itself is a state. This is literally the definition of a state. But when I point this out to socialists and show why this is the case in my public versus private video, they start to cry. Because apparently, pointing out the bleeding obvious means that I'm bad at politics, and that I know nothing about politics, and that I should just stick to tanks. Clearly though, it is these morons saying these things who don't know anything about politics, haven't studied history, and can't even read a dictionary. Socialism is nothing other than state control. Anyway, the point is that syndicalism is all about trade unions. And what is a trade union? A trade union is a union of workers, or a group of workers, a bunch of workers. You could even say a bundle of workers, like a bundle of sticks. In Italian, a bundle of sticks is a fascio. Oh, that's why trade unions in Italy were called fascio, plural fasci. And is why fascism literally means trade unionism, or power to the trade unions. The word fascio means literally bundle, and had been used for a long time as an alternative to union. Fascism is trade unionism, and trade unionism is fascism. It's a good job then that our Marxist professors join trade unions to shout out how they're anti-fascist and how they need a pay rise when they clearly don't, otherwise we might get them confused with actual fascists. Now, if you want to be super specific, the full technical definition of Mussolini's fascism is actually this: national syndicalism with a philosophy of actualism. National because it was for the Italian nation. Syndicalism because it was trade unionism and actually evolved out of the Marxist anarcho-syndicalist movement in Italy. Mussolini was an anarchist at first. And it had a philosophy of actualism, which I'm not going to get into here because it's not really relevant. You can look it up for yourself. But, to quote Gregor, fascism was the totalitarian, cooperative and ethical state, the final collectivist synthesis of nationalism, syndicalism and actualism. In other words, it was trade unionism for Italy, and then actually put into practice. And what do you get when you have a trade union, or syndicate, that becomes an organ for the nation? An organ like a body. It embodies the nation, like a corpse. Body, corpse, corporation. That's where the word corporation comes from. All corporations are organs of the state. It's literally in the name. And they are Marxist syndicates with a different name. So, to distinguish themselves from the Marxists, instead of calling their big trade unions syndicates, they called them corporations. Corporations are inherently Marxist, fascist, socialist organizations. So, if you've ever worked in a corporation, welcome to socialism. Giovanni Gentile was the philosopher who invented the ideology of fascism, which Mussolini put into practice. Gentile believed that the true state, his ethical state, was a corpus, a body politic, hence corporate state, and that the state was more important than the parts, the individuals who comprised it, because if the state was strong and free, so too would be the individuals within it. Therefore, the state had more rights than the individual. Only within the ethical state could individuals realize themselves as proper individuals. So basically, you have to be a slave in the state in order to be free. I mean, this is stupid. It's the same idea that the socialists had, which is why Orwell came out with the freedom is slavery slogan for Big Brother's party. To quote Gentile directly, "The great social and constitutional reform that fascism is accomplishing, instituting the cooperative syndicalist regime as a substitute for the old-fashioned capitalist liberal state, arose out of the very character of the fascist state. Fascism accepted from syndicalism the idea of the educative and moral function of the syndicate. But since the intention was to overcome the antithesis between the state and the syndicate, the effort was made to enter the system of syndicates harmoniously into corporations, subject to discipline by the state, and therefore give expression to the organic character of the state." Mussolini said the same thing. "The people is the body of the state, and the state is the spirit of the people. In the fascist concept, the people is the state, and the state is the people. The tools with which the idealiter is achieved in the state are the party and the corporation." And Gentile also said that fascism was the ultimate form of democracy. "The nationalist state was an aristocratic state that constructed itself out of the force it inherited from its origin, that made it valued by the masses. The fascist state, on the other hand, is a popular state, and in that sense a democratic state par excellence. Democracy means people power, but as Gentile had realized, and as I have pointed out in my public versus private video, the people are the public, and a public is a state, which is why we call it the public sector. Democracy, therefore, is state power, which is why the founding fathers of the United States of America called their government a republic, because they knew that democracy was bad. It's also why North Korea can call itself a democracy, because it actually is one. If the people become the state, then totalitarianism is the highest form of democracy. Hitler also called for a democracy a people's state. It's the exact same principle. The people's state will classify its population in three groups: citizens, subjects of the state, and aliens. We have seen above that the first step in the revolution by the working class is to raise the proletariat to the position of ruling class to win the battle of democracy. Every citizen shares a relationship with the state that is so intimate that the state exists only in so far as it is made to exist by the citizen. Thus, its formation is a product of the consciousness of each individual, and thus of the masses, in which the power of the state consists." You may argue that voting is democracy, but is this really the case? You can vote in a republic like the USA, or in a constitutional monarchy like here in the UK. Voting is just voting. It doesn't require a democracy. Voting and democracy are two separate concepts. Democracy is people power or state power, and fascism, according to its founder, is therefore the ultimate form of democracy. "Liberty is found only in the state, and the state is authority." Gentile had founded the concept of fascism, but Mussolini was the one who put it into practice. Mussolini had been a member of the Marxist Socialist Party of Italy and had believed in Marxist international class socialism. In fact, he had gained notoriety for having become the guy in charge of the Marxist Socialist Avanti newspaper, the biggest Marxist newspaper in the country. Mussolini was the only one among you with the mind and temperament to make a revolution. Why did you allow him to leave? Because, as the other great powers became embroiled in the First World War, the Marxist theory of the proletariat going on strike in opposition to the war, igniting a revolution or stopping the war from starting in the first place, didn't take hold. In fact, the opposite had happened. The socialists and the proletariat had supported their own national governments. Rather than be united internationally, workers rallied behind their individual nation-states, causing the International Marxist Socialist Party to split into national groupings. And in every country, the Marxist Socialist Parties became pro-war and pro their own nation-states, with Italy being the exception. Italy did not enter the war in the first year, and the Italian branch of the International Marxist Socialist Party remained firm in its international convictions, even though the rest of the world did not. But Mussolini, head of the Marxist newspaper, now realized that nationality had more appeal to the regular people than internationalism. Mussolini therefore began to argue for Italy's entry into the war, thinking that this would unite the Italian people in heart and mind. Even though all the other Marxists in Europe had rallied behind their nations, this though was not acceptable to the International Marxist Socialist Party of Italy, and Mussolini was kicked out of the party and excommunicated. So really, the Italian Marxist Party had thrown Mussolini out because he was doing what the rest of the international Marxist movement was doing. The irony. As party members threw objects at him, Mussolini spoke, "I tell you, you are wasting your breath. You will be forced into the war. You cannot get rid of me, because I am and will always be a socialist. You hate me. You hate me because you still love me. What divides me from you now is not a small question. It is a big question that divides all socialism." And that question was nationalism or internationalism. That's it. That's the difference between Marxism and fascism, nationalism and internationalism. Mussolini therefore became a fascist, but Mussolini's fascist party wasn't founded by him. But in fact, the first fascio, called initially the Fascio Revolutionari di Azione Internazionalista, the Revolutionary Union of Internationalist Action, had been formed in October 1914 by others, in particular by the revolutionary syndicalists led by Corradoni and Massimo Rocca. Revolutionary syndicalists were among the first to break ranks with the official socialist position. Panunzio was among them. Mussolini gave his support for the group after he left the Socialist Party, wrote its new manifesto, and dropped the word Internazionalista from the title. And, eager to paint themselves as non-fascists, the Marxist socialists began to deny the origins of fascism. Immediately, the Italian left branded fascism a reactionary force in the service of the bourgeoisie. It would keep on saying so. History by and large has accepted this definition of fascism, but fascism was anything but a right-wing movement. And as a result, and as time has moved on, the vast majority of people now have no idea what fascism means. Recently I did a video where I read out Orwell's What is Fascism, and a lot of people were confused that I had even posted it. I mean, why would I, as a non-socialist, quote a socialist telling you that nobody has a clue what fascism actually is? There were several reasons, but the main point was to show you that nobody has a clue what fascism is, and certainly not the Marxist socialists or the left in general. Despite what some have claimed, Orwell himself was no longer a socialist by the time he wrote 1984. That's why he called Big Brother's totalitarian fascist party ingsoc, English socialism. Even a child can understand the message of Orwell's Animal Farm, which is that socialism becomes fascism. They are the same thing. Yet somehow, many adults have failed to grasp this. By this point in his life, Orwell was jaded by socialism's failures, as documented in many of his later books, and rightly so. Although Orwell never became a capitalist, he had realized that socialism had failed, and had moved away from it. I can relate to that because I did the exact same thing. But the reason people don't know what fascism is because leftist ideologues point-blank refuse to accept the fundamental idea that is central to fascism, and that idea is socialism. By denying the socialism at the heart of fascism, you get a wishy-washy definition of fascism which stands for nothing. In reality, it is socialism by another name. A socialism restricted to the national level. Instead of wanting to have a world revolution, the fascists wanted a revolution for the nation. That's it. Benito Mussolini had emerged from Italian socialism in 1915 in order to become a more faithful interpreter of the will of the people of Italy, to whom he, already editor of the socialist paper Avanti, wished to devote his new journal Il Popolo d'Italia. He argued for the necessity of the war, for Italy's entry into which he was among those truly responsible. Just as he had struggled against masonry while a socialist, inspired by Sorellian syndicalism, he opposed the parliamentary corruption of reformism with the idealistic postulates of revolution and violence in the name of revolution. Outside the ranks of official socialism, he continued his battle against his old comrades, defending the rationale of the war, defending the infrangible moral and economic wholeness of the national organism against the lying fictions of internationalism. He argued for the sanctity of the fatherland, something that would be sacred even for the working classes. He had already transcended the ideology of socialism, first by instinct, then by reflection. And Gentile wasn't the only one who created fascism. Gregor has written a fantastic book called Mussolini's Intellectuals. Not an easy read, but a good book nonetheless. Gregor walks us through the major players in Italian fascism, and every single one of them is either a syndicalist who then adopted nationalism to become a nationalist syndicalist, or a nationalist who embraced syndicalism to become a nationalist syndicalist. There are some who came later and therefore always embraced both concepts, but the point is that fascism clearly emerged from nationalism and syndicalism. So those people ignoring the syndicalism have completely missed the mark. And that's why people are having difficulty defining fascism. They reject the core and fundamental elements of it in order to hide from you the socialism that's inherent in it. And the best part is, I have now figured out where we get the idea from that both Nazism and fascism are the same thing. At first, I just assumed that wartime communist propaganda called the Nazis and the fascists, and then the name stuck. Now, to some extent, this is true. That's why you hear people saying how they're fighting the Germans at Stalingrad, but calling them fascists, which the Germans weren't. The Germans fled in panic from Plodavite. In this fight, up to 60 enemy tanks were destroyed and 40 captured, as well as dozens of guns. Many fascists were taken prisoner. But calling everyone on the Axis side fascists caused problems when the war was over. Nazis in Germany weren't fascists. Another of my patrons, Jim Land, has even asked whether the Nazis called themselves fascists or not. Or is this just something that the Allies and Soviets called them? Well, Hitler never called himself a fascist, and indeed looked down upon fascism. We know from intimates of Hitler and from his table talks that he was highly critical of Italian fascism. While Hitler proclaimed repeatedly that National Socialism and fascism were related in Weltanschauung, or spoke of the community of the fascist and National Socialist Revolution, his criticism of the Italian system grew increasingly sharp, particularly after his visit to Italy in 1938. And Hitler wasn't the only one to criticize fascism. One might almost say that fascism has reacted upon the creative life of the Italian people somewhat like sterilization. It is, after all, nothing like National Socialism. While the latter goes deep down to the roots, fascism is only a superficial thing. That is regrettable, but one must recognize it clearly. National Socialism is really a way of life, ein Weltanschauung. It always begins at the beginning and lays new foundations for life. That's why our task is so difficult, but also so beautiful, and the goal ahead is well worth our best effort. If fascism was national syndicalism with a philosophy of actualism, Nazism was a racial socialism with a philosophy of international conquest, Lebensraum. I've explained what National Socialism is in detail in my 5-hour documentary on Hitler's socialism using 107 sources, 350 direct references, loads of quotes and notes and so on. If you want to know what National Socialism was, I'd recommend you watch that video and ignore the anti-Semitic Marxist trolls in the comments. The point is though that these two ideologies were completely separate from each other. They influenced each other slightly, and then they aligned together during the Second World War, but they weren't the same. And since the Nazis never called themselves fascists, and the fascists never called themselves Nazis, this became a problem for the Allied and Soviet powers after the war. The fascist regime in Italy didn't have death camps. It didn't murder Jews. Only after the Germans marched in and took over were the Jews shipped off to be murdered. It didn't even kill that many of its own people, certainly not to the same extent as the Marxists had done. And the Germans didn't call themselves fascists. So the socialist propagandists had a problem. They had to find a way to associate fascism with Nazism. And if they failed to do that, the game would be up, and everyone would realize that fascism was just a different name for socialism. So, what the Marxists did was, they dived into the fascist party's ideology, looking for anything that could be used to link the ideas of fascism and Nazism together. And they found someone. One person. Just one guy. Yes, one guy who could bridge the gap. They picked the village idiot, a guy called Julius Evola. James Gregor does an absolutely brilliant job of explaining what this guy was about, so if you want the details, his book, Mussolini's Intellectuals, is the one you must get. But I'm going to try and give a brief overview here. Giovanni Prizzosi, Italy's only committed anti-Semite, suddenly resurfaced together with Julius Evola, whom serious fascists were to forever dismiss as the Magic Baron. Julius Evola was a anti-fascist masquerading as a fascist, who then evolved into a semi-national socialist and a complete lunatic. To start with, Evola rejected the notion of the national totalitarian state, which was the central core concept of fascism, and he rejected the violence of the black shirt squads, and he rejected nationalism. Evola even opposed Giovanni Gentile, the founder of fascism. So, in a nutshell, he wasn't a fascist in any way, shape, or form. In fact, Evola was never a fascist, however the term is understood. Nothing of Evola's exotic ruminations appeared in any official fascist doctrinal pronouncements. Evola's writings were to be used exclusively to serve Mussolini's tactical purposes and then be allowed to fade away. Evola was a weirdo, but he was also anti-clerical. So, when Mussolini had problems with the Catholic Church in the 1920s and 1930s, Mussolini wheeled out Evola and said, "Look, if you don't start bowing the knee to fascism, fascism will convert to whatever this lunatic believes in, and you won't like that, will you?" So, the Catholic Church was like, okay, we'll talk. Again, this was purely tactical. But then, in the 1930s, Evola moved from anti-fascism and anti-clericalism to some sort of weird racism which can't even be described as National Socialism. Evola wrote a book in 1941 which detailed his views on what he called spiritual racism. As Gregor points out, Evola was the sole spokesman for his brand of racism. His version of spiritual racism was completely different from even the ritualistic racism that Himmler believed in. Evola did believe in racial souls, like Hans Gunther, the race pope, did, but didn't believe in the Aryan race quite like the Nazis did. Evola thought that there was an Aryan solar Nordic race with a solar Nordic blood. He believed that fascism and National Socialism provided a spirit that would allow a celestial race to cosmically re-emerge on Earth. And this celestial race was the primordial creative race of Hyperborea. Just to fill you in on this one, according to Greek mythology, Hyperborea was a race of giants who lived in the north. So he believed in a giant race. A cosmic giant race. So again, this is beyond the realm of stupidity. And this has nothing to do with fascism or National Socialism. This guy even makes Himmler look sane. Gregor explains that some have claimed that Mussolini read and approved of Evola's racial theories, but this is doubtful, since Mussolini continued to object to the ideas of both Evola and National Socialism, and didn't allow National Socialist-esque racial theories into the doctrine of fascism. Just like he did with the Catholic Church, when Mussolini needed to bridge the gap with the Germans, who they were now in alliance with during the Second World War, he wielded out Evola and said, look, we share the same blood or something, I don't know, give us some raw materials and stuff. It was a tactical move, nothing more. The fact was that there was no anti-Semitism in Italy prior to 1938, and the only reason there was any anti-Semitism after 1938 was because Mussolini went to visit Hitler to try and forge an alliance in 1938. When he came back, he created some anti-Semitic laws to please Hitler and bridge the gap between the two ideologies. Think about it. If fascism and National Socialism were so alike, then why would Mussolini have to create these laws? Surely he would have created them in the 16 years he was in power prior to this point. So again, it was purely tactical. Both Gregor and Farrell explain this to be the case, with Gregor stating that fascist anti-Semitism after 1938 wasn't a permanent feature of the fascist doctrine or ideology. Now, I know there's going to be a lot of quick commenting far lefties in the comments posting things like, what about Ethiopia? That was racist, wasn't it? Again, people who haven't done their homework trying to use the old whataboutism tactic to undermine someone else's points, rather than actually trying to figure out what actually happened. Yes, fascist Italy invaded Ethiopia in the late 1930s and conquered the place. They also committed crimes against the natives. However, if you look at it properly, you'll find that it was done for national economic reasons, not racial ones. In earlier times, Italy's claim on Ethiopia would have been regarded in the civilized world as perfectly logical, given her extensive economic penetration of the country. Attitudes in Britain and France to colonization, however, had changed. Colonization might have been the done thing once when they did the colonizing, but it was not the done thing anymore now that they had their colonies. Anyway, the point is that fascist doctrine and ideology wasn't racist. Racism only became an element due to Mussolini wanting to get into bed with Hitler, and Evola was used to peel back the covers and dim the lights. Irrespective of his contribution to Mussolini's purpose, Evola was never accorded any respect in fascist intellectual circles. And yet, even though Evola was the village idiot, even though he wasn't a fascist, even though he was the outlier, even though the vast majority of fascists and the entire fascist doctrine and ideology rejected what he did and who he was, the Marxists had found exactly what they were looking for. In retrospect, it appears evident that Evola was never particularly interested in fascism as such. In effect, he actually has no place in any history of fascist social and political thought. He is accorded a place because, years after the passing of fascism, discussants have chosen to identify him as the fascist source of the irrationalism and anti-humanism of contemporary extremism. He presumably provided the meaning of fascism for modern revolutionaries. So this guy, Evola, became the symbol of fascism, even though he wasn't a fascist or a Nazi. He was the village idiot. Yet Marxist authors continue to paint him as the guy that fascism is all about. Fascism became an all-purpose term because one can eliminate from a fascist regime one or more features, and it would still be recognizable as fascist. Take away imperialism from fascism and you still have Franco and Salazar. Take away colonialization and you still have the Balkan fascism of the Ustashes. Add to the Italian fascism a radical anti-capitalism, which never much fascinated Mussolini, says Umberto, who shows here that he clearly hasn't read anything about Mussolini, and you have Erza Pound. Add a cult of Celtic mythology and the grail of mysticism, completely alien to official fascism, I'm glad you can actually admit that, Umberto, and you have one of the most respected fascist gurus, Julius Evola. Nope, sorry Mr. Echo, you're completely wrong here. Julius Evola was not a respected fascist guru. He wasn't even a fascist. You are wrong. And what's worse, you mention this guy twice in your famous fascism. And you fail to mention any of the other main fascist intellectuals except Mussolini and Gentile. And you even say, Mussolini did not have any philosophy. He had only rhetoric. Pfft, what a joke. He not only fails to define what fascism is, but proceeds to talk about National Socialism as though it was fascism too. And this is why there's lots of people today still ignorantly mixing the terms fascism and Nazism together, because, just like Umberto Eco, they haven't done their homework. By denying that fascism was a version of socialism, by denying that it was national syndicalism with a philosophy of actualism, Marxist socialists have turned the word fascist into a meaningless statement. You have no idea what fascism is because socialists decided that the meaning and doctrine of fascism was to be forgotten. This is why you have a bunch of racist white people dressed like black shirts claiming they're fighting for racial justice whilst burning down black communities, yet calling themselves anti-fascists. Of course they're anti-fascist, they're not fascist, they're Marxist socialists. And as I've pointed out recently, Marxist socialism is inherently anti-Semitic. So, going back to the original questions, fascism was national syndicalism with a philosophy of actualism. It was trade unionism for the Italians. It wasn't National Socialism, which was a racial socialism, which had race fundamentally built into the ideology. So, just to clarify, you cannot separate the racism from National Socialism, otherwise the whole thing is meaningless. But you can separate it from fascism because fascism doesn't require the concept of racism in order to work. Fascism emerged directly from Marxism, whereas National Socialism emerged from the original ideas of German Socialism, which even predates Karl Marx, and thus has nothing to do with Marxism. The Nazi leadership never called themselves fascists, some of their thugs might have done, but those who understood what the doctrine was didn't, and the fascists didn't call themselves Nazis. The only reason they got thrown together was because they were allied during the Second World War, and wartime socialist propaganda called every Axis nation fascist. It would be as though we all started calling the Western allies Marxists due to the fact that they were allied with the Soviet Union. That would clearly be false, but oh, it's okay to do that with the fascists and the Nazis. Well, I think no, it isn't. Fascism and National Socialism are two distinct ideologies. Both were stupid, both were ridiculous, just like all socialisms, but to say that they're the same is completely false. Thanks for watching, bye for now.